guy, I like a Pender guy, do 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 do, Pender guy, hey hey hey, here comes Pender guy.
Pender what? Are you nuts or something?
No, Pender guy, you know guy, street, Chinese for street, like go guy, kifa guy, sesame guy.
You must be crazy. What guy wa?
Oh.
Pender guy!
Hi, thanks for having me on this panel. I'm delighted to discuss my favorite piece from the Pender Guy archives. First, let me say this. It's important to note that over the course of Pender Guy's complicated life, the many people who came onto the program all had very different reasons and motivations for getting involved. And all those reasons are valid and important. The commitment of those volunteers was very, very real, and I salute all of them. So what I'm going to tell you about now really only applies to me, about why I got involved and why I wrote that particular piece. So to give you a sense of my choice, let me read the opening to Super Pender Guy, The Origins. I must warn you that my reading is nowhere as good as what Barry Wong's original voiceover work was. But here goes anyways. Faster than a Trans Am on the proposed Chinatown freeway, more powerful than an urban renewal bulldozer, can leap over City Hall's pile of red tape in a single bound. Wow, look up there in the sky. It's a bird. No, it's a plane. No, it's Pender Guy. Super Pender Guy uses superhuman powers when the need arises in a never-ending struggle to combat the insidious, ever-lurking forces of racism, the threat of unthinking assimilation, the menace of lying stereotypes, and other evil murderers of Chinese Canadian culture. So that gives you an idea of the exaggerated and hopefully entertaining work that we were doing back in the 1970s. So now I'd like to go back to that time, the 60s and 70s, for some context to explain Super Pender Guy and to connect sort of the political with the personal. So in the mid-1970s, when I started volunteering in Chinatown, I read a very influential critique of the Chinese Canadian world. Now, the 60s and the 70s were very, I guess, heady times in America. The civil rights movement fought for African Americans. Students were protesting the Vietnam War. New parties like the Black Panther Party arose. There were terrible race riots, and Afro-American studies started at American universities. Now, these events affected the three largest Asian groups in America at that time, the Chinese, Japanese, and Filipinos. Now, their English-speaking youth came forth and demanded Asian-American studies at universities. They also demanded more engagement with the Chinatowns, Little Tokyos, Little Manilas, Japantown, International District, the areas where the pioneers and senior citizens faced issues around language, isolation, housing, and social services. And these calls challenge the assimilation model that flourished then. Now, that trend reflected decades of anti-Asian racism in both the U.S. and Canada that had seen the exclusion of Chinese immigrants and the World War II internment of Japanese Americans and Japanese Canadians. Now, after the war, mainstream North America became more accepting of racial minorities. So the thinking was the locally born Asians should become as American or as Canadian as possible and leave behind the dark history of racism and embrace all the opportunities of the mainstream world. And that's how I was raised in Vancouver of the 1960s. I hated going to Chinese school. I yearned to move away from Chinatown to a better neighborhood. And I shrugged at the Chinese community, whatever that was. But all that changed after high school. In 1972, the Wakayama Group of Vancouver published an article in Bridge Magazine with the title, "Why Are There So Few Sansei Writers?" Now, the word Sansei refers to the third generation of the Japanese diaspora. And the article compared the output of novels, poetry, and literary work written by Asian Americans, Asian Canadians, which was very low, compared to the output of African Americans and Jewish Americans, which was impressively high. So why were there so few Asian Canadian writers? The Wakayama group said that because as the English-speaking generations integrated into the mainstream white society, they let go of their mother tongues, they let go of their ties to their communities, and they bought into whatever the mainstream narrative was for us. So if the mainstream said minorities didn't need their own literature, well, that was fine. If the mainstream said race discrimination was dead, we believed them. The Wakayama group argued that as long as the English-speaking generations of Asian Canadians didn't know their history in Canada and didn't identify with their own people, then they would be forever lacking a spiritual gut from which to tell their truths in stories, poetry, or whatever. Now, this is probably obvious now in 2021, but back in the 1970s, this was radical. I tell you, it was radical. And not a lot of Asian Canadians were comfortable talking about this. But I found that analysis fit me. I wasn't comfortable in Chinatown despite growing up there. I knew nothing about Chinese Canadian history. And I thought I knew everything about how to grow up as a racial minority. But that Wakayama Group article changed me because now I felt like I belonged to a community. And with that sense of belonging came an urgency to do more. I had never wanted to write. Now I did. I never thought I had anything important to write about. Now I did. I never thought my family was worth exploring and writing about. And now I did. Now I saw that my family and I were part of a larger whole, part of a Chinese Canadian world that had its own past, as well as stories about how to thrive here in Canada. I belonged to a community, and everybody around me could be empowered if they could see how their own family and their own lives contributed to the larger whole that we were all in. And suddenly, the comic books that I had gobbled up as a kid looked very different. Looking back now, that mini series Super Pender Guy responded to the question from the Wakayama group. I was younger then. I knew only the easy pieces of Chinese Canadian history, yet I wanted to write. I wanted to say, yeah, we can change those words so few in that title. And so we wanted to write. And Pender Guy, the radio program, offered us a chance to be heard. Radio was cheap compared to staging a play. It required less time than writing a novel, and it didn't require the extensive skills needed to go on TV. So that was step one. With a superhero, we were working within a familiar genre, the comic book genre, and with the golden age of radio formats from the 1940s and 1950s that had been all powerful in North America. We wanted an alternative, a hero from our history and our community. And the comic book genre was loaded with standard features. The superhero has a secret identity as a normal person. The setting is in a big city where there's excitement and danger. And the hero has a mythic backstory to explain where those superpowers come from. And of course, the hero is called upon to go on dangerous quests. We spoofed the genre. So, for example, our language was filled with cliches, like, meanwhile, back on the railway tracks, or we gave the villains these terrible lines like, we're going to take it to Toronto, see, and you're going to help us, see, or we'll make your father disappear, see. And our hero says, where do you guys learn to talk like that? Anyways, so the end product was loaded with special effects from the sound studio, you know, echo chambers, Star Wars type music, interludes, all to create the right atmosphere. And Super Pender Guy was a chance to be creative, to give free rein to our imagination. We poked fun at the dominant culture and at ourselves. We made a Chinatown of our own imagination. But the more important thing was we were all young then and we could take chances and we wanted to have some fun. Thank you.
Super Pender Guy is a Chinese Canadian hero. He has superpowers, but he also has a social conscience. Let's hear it for Super Pender Guy.
Faster than a Trans Am on the proposed Chinatown freeway. More powerful than an urban renewal bulldozer. Can leap over city hall's pile of red tape in a single bound.
Wow. Gosh, gee. Yeah.
Look, up in the sky.
It's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Pender Guy.
Pender Guy, I am not Pender Guy, believe it.
Shipped over from the distant city of Canton and disguised as a meek and mild piece of CPR tracked in Chinatown, Pender Guy uses superhuman powers when the need arises.
Hello, Sosan?
In a never-ending struggle to combat the insidious, ever-lurking forces of racism, the threat of unthinking assimilation, the menace of lying stereotypes, and other evil murderers of Chinese-Canadian culture. With an amazing superhuman voice that can sing.
Get up, stand up for your
instruct.
Today we are presenting Chinese Canadian.
Tell stories.
There's a popular anecdote that's been circling around.
Interview.
Hello, I'm Tony Wong.
Swear.
Oh, fudge!
Loud.
Again.
In both male
and female
tones, Pender Guy yodels. Letting the boring message echo with garbled clarity from the cloud-piercing summit of Gamsan. Crisp spring day in Vancouver's bustling Chinatown as Larry Liu, young, handsome, and 25, sets up his newspaper stand on Pender Street. The bundles of fresh newsprint are finally stacked up neatly, and Larry is soon doing a brisk business.
Thank you, sir. Here's your change. Chinatown Times? Yep, right here. 20 cents. Thank you, thank you. No, I don't have any Chinatown magazines. Get lost. What do you think this is? A porno stand? Hey, come back with my radio.
What's this? Some scoundrel has just run off with Larry's portable Vagabond brand radio. Larry can't afford to lose the radio. After all, he's still making payments on it. He sets off in hot pursuit towards the harbor. Unfortunately, the thief is nimble-footed, and soon the pursuit tears along the CPR tracks along Vancouver's waterfront. Suddenly, the thief stops. He can run no further.
I've got you now. Give me back my... Hey, watch out! Don't throw!
In desperation, the thief tosses the radio at Larry before he ducks off. As Larry lurches forward to catch the radio, he stumbles, trips, and he and the radio smash down together onto the tracks.
Oh, my knee! Ah! My radio!
The radio is sadly splattered all over the tracks. But what's this? The radio has started to sputter.
Get up, Larry Liu.
Who's that? There's nobody around.
Get up, Larry Liu. Hurry. Time is short.
Larry is mystified. There's a strange voice coming out of his shattered radio, even when the batteries have been knocked out.
Is this some joke? This is spooky. I'm getting out of here.
Larry Lou, stop. You must hear us out. Please.
Larry is scared shitless, but intrigued nevertheless.
What's going on? What do you want?
There is nothing to fear. Pick up the radio. That is better. We are the Gumsun Fathers. Gumsun Fathers. We are the spirit of all the Chinese pioneers who built Canada. A spirit nurtured on struggle, sweat, blood, tragedy, and injustice. We need your help.
This is like a comic strip. What? My help? What can I do?
There is no time to explain. Stand still. We are going to take a journey.
Flash! Shazam! Suddenly, Larry disappears off the tracks in a flash of white light. Incredible! Where have they gone? Off to some distant galaxy or just to Shanghai Alley? Taxi, follow that flash!
Well, thanks everyone for being here, and especially to ACCW for bringing us together today. Slightly out of chronological order, because if Paul gets to be known as a Pender Guy founder, I think that makes me a Pender Guy loser. Because I joined the show in the final year and a half of its life. I was a late bloomer to my Chinatown awakening, having spent my teens in mostly white middle-class Burnaby and gone to SFU, not UBC. I hadn't heard about or knew anything about Pender Guy until I attended a meeting at the CBA to cover CTV's offensive W5 episode for the Chinatown News. And at that time, I was just starting broadcast journalism school, also in white middle-class Burnaby. In other words, youth and Chinatown were basically unexplored for me. So you can be sure I was curious about these young microphone-carrying nerds at that meeting, and I signed up happily to volunteer. But since I was coming from a wannabe journalism background, current affairs became my focus and my main contribution. I did try my hand at what I thought were more poetic and creative scripts, but as it turns out, I'm not that poetic or funny, and I learned comedy is really hard to pull off. So you know what, when Super Pender Guy, when I heard that, I was like, so in such awe. The episode I want to discuss is a true life story, which put me in the awkward zone of being participant and journalist. In class, I was learning that reporting on something that actually happened to you was frowned upon, for one. The goal was to aim for objectivity, but from whose point of view? If you wanted to work in mainstream media, then obviously that point of view is the white mainstream majority. But Pender Guy gave us the freedom to report from our perspective. So I'll try to summarize what happened. In 1979, I was entertaining a group of Chinese American friends visiting from the Bay Area. This was the era of disco, so you know what, park your judgment somewhere else. I took them to the candy store disco at the Royal Center and was told by the Chinese Canadian doorman there that the entry fee was $5. Well, that's a cup of coffee today, but back then, that $5 could practically pay for the silver-plated urn it was served in. Suffice to say, we decided to have wholesome fun somewhere else. And as we were leaving, one of my Vancouver friends said, you know, they always charge Chinese $5 and whites $3. I was so shocked that I actually went into a phone booth and stuck in my dime and called the candy store to inquire what was the entry fee tonight. And they said $3. I took my outrage to what was then the British Columbia Human Rights branch, and we did an investigation. And in the end, we settled with the owners and received a public apology in the newspaper and a total of $500, which we donated to the Chinese Cultural Center. My friends and I also went to City Hall to argue why the disco should have its license lifted, and we lost. All this is recorded in the Pender Guy episode, a half-hour documentary produced with Kiemen Wong and Barry Wong. We recount the story and discuss similar cases of discrimination against Black patrons at Misty's Disco. We interviewed participants, human rights advocates, community activists, and the colorful, outspoken city alderman at the time, Harry Rankin. That documentary, along with one that Keeman produced on the W5 protest, won Co-op Radio the B'nai B'rith Media Human Rights Award in 1980. For the first time, Pender Guy was actually in the news and being honored in the mainstream. Hallelujah! We were just thrilled someone was listening. If you do hear this episode, I apologize wholeheartedly for allowing the use of the word Oriental, which now offends my ears. 42 years ago, though, the word was still in common usage, although with some growing discomfort. I've heard Henry Yu say the term Asian is the word that replaces Oriental. I also used the pseudonym Judy Wong for that story, in part because I was getting some anonymous telephone calls at home and I was worried it was connected to having spoken out. And then by then I was also working for radio news at CFMI under my own name. But I digress. Reliving that episode four decades later, it does not surprise me or shock me that anti-Asian racism is alive and well in this time of COVID. We have long been scapegoated throughout our history here. And in that context, I don't find the current hate as outrageous as I would have had if I would have when I was in my 20s. I still don't know what to do about it, other than to point it out, argue for education, and stand by other minorities when it happens to them. Sometimes it feels that settler colonial Canada has made great strides in embracing us all, and other times I know we are still viewed as foreigners. I went down the rabbit hole in preparing for today and had the pleasure of listening to other episodes of Pender Guy that I'd never heard before. It gave me a renewed sense of pride in what we accomplished over those 5 years. And we weren't there together, although I never had the privilege of being in the studio with you, Paul, or Jeannie, or you, Tommy. I know that we all shared the desire to reflect the diversity of the Chinese Canadian experience, to speak truthfully and boldly, to use as much creativity as we could muster to get our views across as full Canadians. In radio, our voices could be heard without the complications and assumptions being made by seeing the color of our hair or the shape of our eyes. Maybe that gave us the freedom to be so expressive. As I said, we really had no idea who was listening on the other side of the radio, but I do know the people on our side of the microphone were all transformed in some way. I feel as if I grew up when I joined Pender Guy. It's when I came to understand that I needed to look behind me and beside me to acknowledge and celebrate our presence here and to determine which way we wanted to go. I'd like to think the show and its ideas are just as relevant today as they were in 1976. And it makes me wonder if anyone out there would like to restart a program such as this. There's new energy and a much more diverse and open Chinese Canadian presence now. And all you have to do is call it a podcast with a Chinese Canadian perspective. Thank you for indulging me in taking this trip down memory lane with us. A special hello to any of the former 65 or so Pender Guy members who might be Zooming in today. And thank you also to allow me to give a warm shout out to Barry Wong, the one constant Pender Guy member who was there from beginning to the end and to this day keeps the show alive and its philosophy. Finally, I just want to talk about preserving the tapes. They have a sad effect of shedding or degrading over time, and it's been a long journey. We are indebted to Co-op Radio for keeping our large wooden cabinet in which the master tapes were stored long after we folded, to the Chinese Canadian Library Service Association, who opened their doors and made room for that said cabinet. Then to the Museum of Anthropology, where they were taken from my basement and treated to a temperature-controlled environment by the experts there. And finally to the City of Vancouver Archives, full circle for you, Paul, which received the tapes and a grant last year to digitize them. I hope the shows will remain a treasure for researchers and anyone interested in the issues that affected Chinatown. And I invite you all to dip in and listen and discover what relevance you may find for your own journeys. Thanks.
Section 3, Chapter 119 of the Human Rights Code of British Columbia.
No one can discriminate against any person or group of people with respect to any service or facility that is customarily available to the public unless reasonable cause exists for such discrimination and the race of any person or group of people does not constitute reasonable cause.
Under the agreement worked out between the Human Rights Branch and the candy store management, the candy store was required to
provide the group with a letter of apology,
eliminate all differential cover charges by posting one admission charge applicable to all patrons,
donate $500 to the Chinese Cultural Center Building Fund. The money could have gone to the individuals involved, but it didn't.
And I want to thank the organizers as well as the participants today for this opportunity for me to give a long overdue word of thanks to Pender Guy and all the friends that I've made through Pender Guy. That experience remains very, very important in my life. Although my involvement in Pender Guy was not long. It was just for a brief few months, up to a year, I think. Couldn't have been that long. But the episode that I've chosen is the very first program number one. and segment number six, which was the part that I co-hosted with Barry Wong. And listening to it after 40 years really is fabulous. that segment was entitled Between Us Chinese. It was the name was taken from the title of a conference, a youth conference, under the name of Between Us Chinese, which was to explore the relationship between the native-born and the immigrant Chinese-Canadian. The episode, as I said, was the very first production of Pender Guy, produced way back on July 18, 1976. And it featured Barry Wong as the boisterous, outgoing native born, and myself as the quiet and studious immigrant. Although I was supposedly a co-producer of a segment of the program, I was honestly more of a tag-along admirer, you know? It was just fascinating. It was magical. It was wonderful. I mean, I can remember that echo in my head, you know, Pender Guy, you know? it's fascinating.
Pender Guy!
Between Us Chinese. Hello, I'm Tommy To, and sitting beside me is Barry Wong. Barry, we're on the air now. Isn't there something you want to say?
Just a minute. I had it just on the tip of my tongue. You see, I had this really incredible party yesterday, and that all just cleared my mind completely. Like, wow, I mean, it just wiped it clean.
Oh, come on, Barry. Let's be serious for a while, huh? Let's tell the listeners something about our program.
What program?
This program. Between us Chinese.
I see. yeah. Well, seriously, some of our friends, our sisters, brothers, and we have found that there's a sort of gap between native-born Chinese Canadians and new Chinese Canadians from abroad. You know, like, have you ever been to, a skating party or, maybe at some dance, and noticed that quite often the two groups just don't seem to be able to mix that well, you know? You know what I mean? You might tend to see, depending on your own background, one group as being too quiet and restrained, or the other group is just childishly boisterous, you know?
That's what I'll say about you, Barry. Childishly boisterous.
And this is what I'll say about you.
Anyways, this program is really an offspring of the Between Us Chinese Conference. Some of you may have attended that conference already. It was held at UBC earlier this year. In the conference, we sort of examined the gap between the native-born and the immigrant Chinese in terms of the stereotypes and cultural differences.
It's so wonderful to see the faces of Paul Yi, Ramona Mar, and Tommy To. I've heard of you guys, but I never had a chance to work together with you in the studios. As for Paul Yi, he's my childhood friend. We went to Strathcona, Britannia together, and even Mun Crown School. So I'm excited to talk about Pender Guy today. Actually, my name was Jeannie Chow, was listed on the Pender Guy record. In 1976, I met Barry Wong, one of the original members of Pender Guy, and he invited me to join the group. At that time, I was studying at UBC in biochem / food science, and I finished my studies in 1978, and later on, I started working for Food Talk, a government project, as a community worker and nutrition educator for disadvantaged groups in East Vancouver. But all through that time, I was walking down to the Pender Guy studios and participating in the programs. And we volunteers would go meet in the evenings at the studio that Jim Wong Chu rented and work on all our segments to put together for the radio program. As an elder brother to us, Jim, I thank Jim for his generosity. And a few years back, Jim passed away due to a stroke, so we missed him very dearly, as he was a great influence in the community, encouraging many writers and artists. I like to talk about the segments I was involved in the Pender Guy program. One of the highlights that you guys will put a link to was my interview with the owner and worker, William, of On Tea Garden on 214 East Kiefer. It was invaded by Pierre and Margaret Trudeau. And for you younger folks, they were the parents of Justin Trudeau. I was surprised to learn that the restaurant opened in 1955 and was a popular spot for local people to frequent. After the Trudeau's visit, many Caucasians tried out the restaurant. There were very long lineups. Even on the rainy day that I interviewed people, the consensus was that the prices were reasonable and food was delicious.
On Tea Garden is one of the most well-known Chinese restaurants in Vancouver. Ken Wong and Larry Wong, same surname but unrelated, have been operating On at 214 East Pender since 1955. In those days, the restaurant consisted of a coffee counter and booth. Breakfast foods were served, but discontinued as the demand for it was lacking. Around 1960, the coffee bar was torn down and booths replaced it. In 1969, On took over a small square property east, adjacent to the alley rented by Kay Soon Vegetable Shop. Further expansion occurred in 1973 when a property west of Annan, formerly Harry James Insurance Agency, was taken over. Why are you coming to this restaurant?
Because Trudeau was here.
Is that all?
Best food in town.
Really? What do you think about the prices?
Very good. Very good prices. For a long time, this has been a real good Chinese restaurant. The prices have been right, food's good, and the waiters are very hospitable.
Oh, that's nice to hear. What special food do you like eating here?
Everything.
Can you name a few?
Not really. Not really.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Why do you like coming to this restaurant?
Because the food's good and the prices are good, too. And it's good because you can bring your own bottle in if you want a drink and that, and it cuts down the price of the meal that way, too. And it's really good food.
I'm genuinely so honored to be on this panel. It's full of people that I only knew as names on little handwritten index cards that are part of the Pender Guy archives. I just remember reading over them and looking at all the different materials and being so fascinated. And now I actually get to hear your stories and see your faces and hear your, and all of this is just such an incredible experience. I almost want to use my time just to ask you all a million questions instead of going into my own experiences. But hopefully that can take place in the Pender Guy Round 2 podcast. So we'll see. What I'll be doing today instead is bringing forward this timeline a few decades into 2015, a few years after the show has ended, but still having very much resonance for me in my life. I graduated from UBC with an English honors and Asian Canadian Asian migration minor, which was the start of my journey with Pender Guy Radio. So this whole experience really starts with a story, and it starts with me. Again, sitting in a Chinatown event by myself, feeling very lost, not knowing anybody or any of the legacies. And then Elder leans over and says to me, "Did you know that Chinatown saved barbecue meats?" And I was like, "We did? What does that tell me more about that?" And he tells this incredible tale of how barbecue meats were almost banned in Vancouver, but all the Chinatowns across Canada came together and saved this precious food product. And it's still something that my family can enjoy on a weekly basis. And that actually led me into my thesis project on the myth status of the 1968 to 1979 barbecue meats protests here in Vancouver. And it led to the website and the documentary short that Winnie mentioned, and it completely transformed my life. What's really key is that none of that work would have been possible without the Pender Guy radio show. Those tapes were some of the only primary documents that existed about these protests. There were some articles in the Vancouver Sun. There was one tiny paragraph, actually, in Salt Water City, written by Paul Yee that I read 10,000 times, trying to extract as many details as possible. And also one article in the unpublished manuscript that another Chinatown elder stuffed into my backpack and told me not to share with anybody, but I could read it for my own reference. So I think that speaks to how much of these stories are really interpersonal. And it's through these connections. So Chris Lee, who was my thesis supervisor and also director of the ACAM program, he knew April Liu, who worked at the Museum of Anthropology at UBC, who had just received the tapes and the materials for one of Mars' basement when she, I can't remember how they got into the MOA. But at that point, it was just index cards, some of the posters, the t-shirts, and all the tapes were still in real format. And they couldn't be digitized by MOA because they were so fragile at that stage and they didn't have the equipment to actually digitize them without causing more damage to the physical tape itself. So that moment when I first opened that Pender Guy box and I saw those vivid, like beautiful posters with the red stamps and all of the material, I was like, this is like stuff that we do now in Chinatown. Like we're always trying to make t-shirts and posters and logos when we try to organize in Chinatown. And it was so great to see, it was so great to see that the elders now were once youth, like that they were also doing the same fun thing. The same kind of, wow, how can we make it appealing and interesting for everybody? And I felt like I really had found a community across time when I opened that box for the very first experience. And those handwritten index cards, the ones that I read every single one of the titles, I mean, now we're very lucky because through the efforts of June Chow and the Vancouver Archives, they're now all completely digitized. But that experience of reading those index cards and not being able to access those tapes was torture. The titles are so interesting. It's like Pender Guy meets like this guy, and then like this interview with this key figure. And then I just had so many I wanted to see. And through this kind of very obsessive reading of those index cards, I was able to meet Barry Wong. It's same as everyone else. He was the one who also pulled me into my Pender Guy radio journey. When I first mentioned this, Paul Yee actually described him as the brain and heart of Pender Guy, and he is 100% that. When we first met, I told him who I was and what I was doing my research for. He sat me down and talked to me for 3 hours about like audio waves and space and time and gravitational wave. I think that we just discovered that gravitational waves are real, and he's explaining to me what that was and how it connects to the space-time transition of Pender Guy. It was one of the most memorable conversations I've ever had in my life, and as part of that conversation, I was able to have, actually, I should go back on this. I didn't just magically have these digitized tapes I could then use in my research in my film. He bussed every day to that Chinatown museum in the cold, in the rain. This was part of the semester, so it was in the winter, where he would manually digitize all these films for me, take the bus out to UBC, where he had shrink-wrapped physical discs of the tapes, and then delivered them to me in my work office. He came all the way to my work office over in Canadian Literature, which is not accessible, by the way. It's like a 20-minute walk from the bus stop, and he had to like go into this basement, come knock on my door, and then give me those tapes. So sometimes when I hear, oh, Christy, wow, your film won an award, I'm like, I didn't win anything. Everyone else just put all that effort into giving me this knowledge and sharing all these stories, and all I had to do was pop open Adobe Premiere and then move around some audio and video things. All the work was in the community. And that's actually one of the tapes that I've selected for my excerpt, and that's number 80, which includes an interview with Barry Morgan, who is then the Federal Health Protection Minister, talking about why it was justified that the barbecue meats were banned in Chinatown. Yeah, it was such an adventure. The whole thing has really been such a meaningful experience for me in finding community and in understanding histories and feeling almost like I've been gifted something that I need to take care of now and re-gift back to the next generation. I know I'm a youth on this panel, but every year I become less youth and there are more youth rising up that would definitely love to hear these stories. That same elder that actually first told me about those protests and stuffed resources into my backpack, he recently gifted me a goji tree. And he told me to give it lots of light for growth and lots of water for nourishment and talk to it every now and again to help it grow better. And this makes me think of how these stories are kind of like that tree. And in the same way that I've been given this, it's now my responsibility to take care of them and to pass it on to other youths that I may end up mentoring. And yeah, so that's my Pender Guy experience. I think there's going to be more, and I'm very much looking forward to what that will look like. I will pass it off to Rach to better explain the listening party, because they really made it all happen with the residency. So yeah.
And now, from our social issues department this week, Pender Guy looks into the Chinatown barbecued meat controversy, which has again made the news, this time appearing in a recent newspaper column by James Barber of the Vancouver province, in which he stated to the effect that some of Chinatown's barbecued meat stores would be closed down beginning next month. For the past few years, the question of whether or not the production and keeping of barbecued meat in these stores has contributed to food poisoning has been debated. In examining this issue, Pender Guy's Don Yee contacted both an official of the Federal Health Protection Branch and a Chinatown barbecued meat merchant for their views on this matter.
Mr. Barry Morgan right now, who is the chief of food inspection at the Federal Health Protection Branch of Health and Welfare. Now, Mr. Morgan, can you tell me the purpose of the Federal Health Protection Branch?
Yes, the Health Protection Branch is the federal agency that's responsible for enforcing the Food and Drug Act and regulations. And this is designed as consumer protection to protect the Canadian public from health hazards related to the sale of foods, drugs, cosmetics, and medical devices.
I see. Now, recently there's been a controversy about the keeping of barbecue pork in certain stores in Chinatown, Vancouver. Now, could you tell me your past association with some of the barbecue pork merchants?
Yes, we've been involved with discussions with the association for the past 3 years. Approximately 3 years ago.
And I'm so honored to be part of this panel. And it's funny because I've actually talked to Ramona and Paul on the phone before, back when I was a student, but I had never put a face to a voice until now. So I'm really excited to talk a little bit more about that. So the whole story with the listening party. So much like an elder had stuffed some like unpublished manuscripts in Christie's backpack and said, hey, do you know this? That kind of happened for me when I was in university, still at UBC, and studying in the media studies program and the Asian Canadian Asian Migration Studies program. So I was a young microphone carrying nerd, as Ramona had said at the time. And so I was involved with CITR, which is UBC's community campus radio station. And at the time we were part of the Plot residency at Access Gallery on East Georgia Street. And at the time I was the spoken coordinator of CITR student executive. So having grown up in Vancouver's Chinatown, my mom had a business in Sunhwa Center on Kiefer Street. I went there after school every day. I would go across the street to like Maxim's to get food. And my mom would remind me to make sure the change was right, like things like that. I was really connected to the community. And so I really wanted to do something related to Chinatown and radio during that time that we were at Access Gallery as a radio station. And so what happened was June Chow, who, much like that elder, as I was talking about, talked to Christy. I asked June, okay, is there anything that's Chinatown and radio related? And June Chow essentially said two things. Pender Guy Radio, talk to Christy Fong. Two words. And so Christy and I had already been good friends at that point. And so it was a really natural connection between the two of us to get something started. And Christy had told me about the work that she had done with Under Fire and working with Barry and the tapes that she had access to. And I said, great, let's make this happen. And so that's how the listening party came to be. And I'll post a little link here so folks can see the design of the poster and what we talked about at the event. But it was actually inspired by the Pender Guy ephemera that we saw at MOA with the stamp and the logo. And so we took a riff on that design to make the poster for the listening party. And what we had done at the listening party was that we had clips of the Pender Guy episodes, and Christy and I had facilitated this sort of discussion and listening party at Access Gallery. And part of the reason for that was because we wanted to think through what it meant, the fact that Chinatown was this change in community, especially with the rise of gentrification, and how art spaces might be contributing to that. So we wanted to kind of envelop all that complexity into this listening party and for members of the community, old and new in Chinatown, to consider all those things together. So that was a really unique and fun time at the Pender Guy Radio listening party. And everyone was really thrilled to hear the tapes for the first time in 30 years, three decades. And so actually what happened was, after that listening party, it inspired me to create a radio documentary called The Young and the Resistant. I actually riffed off of the name The Young and the Restless, if folks are familiar with this long-standing soap opera on daytime television. So the reason why I created this radio documentary at the time was, this was actually around 2017, 2018, was the height of the 105 Kiefer Street fights in Vancouver's Chinatown. And for those who aren't familiar, it's essentially a lot that is right behind or right across from Chinatown's Memorial Square and right across from Sun Yat-sen Garden and Chinese Cultural Center. And there was a development that was being proposed of primarily market condos. And there was a huge uprise and resistance from the community against this development for fear of further gentrification of the neighborhood. And so there was a lot of youth organizing at that time to bring elders together, community members together to speak at City Hall and push back against this proposal. And so it was through that that I was inspired to kind of look into the history of youth organizing in Vancouver's Chinatown. And that's how I learned about the work of Pender Guy and Ramona's work, you know, inquiring into the discotheque that was acting in a discriminatory way against Chinese Canadians, and also Paul Yee's work with Pender Guy in general. And so I decided to do this thing where I fused the past and present, and I interviewed youth activists, dear friends of mine, Yolanda Lui and Amanda Wan. Yolanda is actually the founder of Yarrow Intergenerational Society for Justice, who's doing really great work in Vancouver's Chinatown as a social service organization. And then I also interviewed Ramona and Paul over the phone about this documentary to bring all of those things together. And that was a really great experience for me to see that, you know, even though time has passed, that that spirit and that energy of youth organizing in Chinatown remains the same. And so, you know, that kind of energy gets carried across generations, and it still remains, I think, even today. Unfortunately, at the time, I didn't get to include the actual Pender Guy radio clips in the documentary itself because of the kind of murkiness around copyright. But now that it's public, Christine and I are talking about all the things that we want to do or revisit. And so I'm hoping that I could make another The Young and the Resistant Revisited to include those clips and perhaps new interviews with all of you here who have taken the time to attend the panel. I'm mindful of the time, so I want to save room for Q&A, but that's what I wanted to share about the listening party and the radio documentary, and it's such a pleasure to be on this panel with all of you. Thank you.
But within the last few years, there's been an association formed by some of the barbecued pork merchants. Now, I'm speaking right now to Mr. Tom Hua Zhao of the Fong Li Company on Pender Street. Now, Mr. Tom, can you tell me something about the forming of the Chinatown Barbecue Pork Merchants Association? When did it form and why?
Well, I don't know exactly what time we formed the association, but quite a few years ago, it seems around 1973, I guess so.
Oh. What were the reasons for forming?
Well, the reason we formed it because we have to get together and then trying to find a way to solve the problem, and try to find a way to make our cabinet like a heating cabinet to keep our product just to meet the law of what the temperature is. As far as I know, I didn't know any case in around Chinatown barbecue. And I did ask Dr. Bonham about that. He said, so far I haven't got a case for it yet.
Most of this food poisoning that's been coming up in the news has been coming from fast food restaurants, hotels, and places like these.
Well, this is what James Barber said.
So, summing up, do you really think there's a problem, as some people say there is, about barbecue meat being sold?
Well, I can't see any problem because we have been selling that for our own store. Well, it have been since my grandfather here. It's over 60 years we're selling that kind of product. So far, I haven't got any problem with that kind of food poisoning. Mm-hmm. And also, around Chinatown, it's over 70 years
right.
History here, but it seems we haven't got any problem.
No problem. Then.
And in China, we got over 2,000 years. There's no problem with that kind of food poisoning.
I kind of introduced the whole idea to people because at that time there was a guy by name Ban Liang. He got I think about 4 hours from the CRRO, and he has extra time. He can produce it and he wants to see if the group of people would like to take it over, and so we did. And I think Tommy and Paul and we'll probably remember that, and we had the discussion, and so we took it over. And at that time, My English was so poor. If I were to go in front of the microphone, people wouldn't understand what I was saying. You probably couldn't understand what I'm saying either now. But that's the story back then. And so if you ask Paul and Barry and people in the front, at the beginning, the first 3 or 4 months, you probably would remember all those chewing gums. I was behind the booth with Don Yi, and Barry was there and helping as well. One credit we probably should give is beyond the people involved with Jim Wong Chu and others at the beginning. The government actually, Canadian government actually gave a grant, a summer student grant, that actually allowed Pender Guy to have people like Tommy and myself and Anthony and a few other people. Tommy probably will remember more, of actually getting paid for a summer job. And that's how Pender Guy was able to grow. So we were able, and Success was a sponsor for that program. So, listening back to the stories, it just touches me. What touched me more though is seeing the young folks, Rachel and Christy, and wanting to continue to that work. One thing that's unique about Pender Guy, and I don't know if it's able to continue on, is the cooperation between the first generation, the new immigrants like Tommy and I and Anthony, and work with the native borns. I don't see too much of that happening now, so maybe Christian Rachel can explain why. I'll shut up now.
I think this program was very unexpected. To have this program draw out the emotions from me. I mean, Pender Guy was long forgotten in my mind, but today's session has made me very emotional, has confirmed what I've always believed in, and I thank people like Christy and Rachel for doing that, because it really is about, you know, we look at community, and community is people, and it's about generations of people. So it's really enheartening for me to see that people are coming forward and saying, yeah, we want to do something here too. You know, when we left, we had no idea what was going to happen. Chinatown had its own life, and we were just, you know, pawns just moving through. But it's so reassuring to see that people are taking up, you know, the torch or whatever, and doing new and interesting and important things. I followed the 105 Kiefer Street thing, and I thought, wow, this is amazing. And Vancouver has always been the heart of so much of sort of Chinese Canada's heart in terms of the issues that go on, in terms of the history and the focus. You know, people look to Vancouver for inspiration, for direction, all of that. And because its position, you know, between, you know, China, Hong Kong, and Vancouver, and then all the way over to Toronto, you know, that's why Vancouver has such an important place. And that's why, you know, things like Pender Guy will probably only happen in Vancouver. Enough. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Christy. Really, from my heart.
If you listen to Vancouver's co-op radio back in the late 1970s, there's a good chance you heard this show.
In Toronto, it's Dundas Street. In San Francisco, it's Grant Avenue. And the main street in Vancouver's Chinatown is Pender Street. In Chinese, that street is called Pender Guy. And this is the program that captures the spirit of that street. We are Pender Guy.
Pender Guy Radio was a collective formed by a group of Chinese Canadian young people in Chinatown, and their goal was to teach radio skills to other Asian Canadians so they could tell stories about their own communities. Well, tomorrow, 40 years since the last show aired, they'll be coming back for a reunion show. Now, Clarence Seho was an original member of the Pender Guy Radio Collective, and he's been good enough to join us on the line this morning. Good morning to you, Clarence.
Good morning, Stephen.
Tell us a little bit about the work that the kind of work that Pender Guy Radio did back in the day.
Well, we did a great diversity of work. We engaged in investigative journalism, probably highlighted by a couple of documentaries that some of our members did. They sort of coordinated a response to that infamous CTV campus giveaway documentary that aired in the late 70s.
And it reminded me of what that was exactly.
Well, it was a documentary produced by CTV, and essentially their message was that Canadian university places were being given away to foreigners rather than Canadians. And the problem was, in one of their images, they showed a bunch of Chinese students claiming that they were foreigners, when in fact they were Canadian-born citizens. So the message was, perhaps if you were Chinese, you weren't Canadian.
Right.
So
you guys exposed that.
We exposed that, or certainly reacted to that and helped organize a community response. We did many other things. We tried to promote local musicians and artists. We tried to bring stories of our history to the forefront. And because before I joined, I was pretty ignorant of our own history, of my own family story of immigration.
Right.
And I had no idea. I really didn't have a lot of curiosity at that time. So we attempted to dig into local history, memories of about the veterans who participated in the war, who agitated to join the military, and just let people know what we had done, what our struggles were, and celebrate our identity.
And
I just want to correct you. Sorry, I just want to correct you a little bit, Stephen. I was not an original member. I was part of the second wave.
Okay.
And I came and joined the group in 1977.
Okay. Well, we're still in the 70s, so I feel like
I feel like
we're safe there. And so obviously the show had a really personal impact on you if it sent you, on an examination of your own heritage and history.
It did. It certainly did. As I said, I was in 1977. I was probably a typical teenager, living in my own world, trying to make my way through society, and I didn't really give much thought. I had no curiosity about where I came from, some of the experiences my parents or grandparents had when they arrived in Canada or moved to Vancouver. So I was very ignorant about these issues. So joining Pender Guy and meeting all these talented people who had much more experience than I did in dealing with community issues, I learned a great deal.
And
it serves me to this day as well.
And I want to play a clip. This is something that you helped write and produce. Let's have a listen.
Today, we of the younger generation salute our pioneer forefathers who endured the long and arduous journey on the century-long road to equality. Working with much courage and determination, they have succeeded in leaving with us boundless opportunities in every business imaginable, from laundries to law to parliament. But the job is not yet complete. We anxiously await the day when Canada will have her very first Chinese-Canadian NHL hockey player!
What goes through your mind when you hear that now?
That brings back a lot of great memories. I have to tell you, that is probably the source of a great pride for me, because we did that so long ago. But it was also my biggest mistake. And I'm not sure if some people caught it at the time. So I'll just give you a really quick background.
Sure.
We plucked up the courage to perform live in front of an audience. We performed a bunch of skits. And we probably had no business doing that because we weren't professionals. I was certainly not a performer or an actor. But we did it. We assembled at some community hall in Chinatown.
Mm-hmm.
And we felt we were in the big time. We had a sound effects man and everything. And people were very kind, and they laughed and supported us. So it was a really fun experience. I had a great time doing that. It's something I had never done before. But that was the final punchline in the whole show.
Mm-hmm.
And when we packed up, someone came up to me and said, Clarence, thank you very much. We had a lot of fun. You guys did great. But do you realize there was actually someone from Kamloops, a Chinese Canadian who played one shift in the NHL in 1948 for the New York Rangers? And of course, I had no idea. And he was, of course, referring to Larry Kwong from Kamloops.
Oh, my gosh.
Who has since been, you know, he's since passed away.
Yeah.
But he's now received his due recognition. And, I had no idea. There was no internet. I probably wouldn't have made that mistake today. But that person was kind enough to, you know, tell me the truth. And if he's out there listening, thank you very much. But, you know, I'll never forget that. It was a lot of fun, but the source of my greatest mistake.
Clarence, we're going to have to leave it there for time this morning. Listen, thank you so much. It's so great to talk with you, and really appreciated hearing the old radio.
My pleasure. Thank you very much, Stephen.
You take care.
Okay.